we go. That gives us about 5 minutes before we're on. Our mics are hot. They can hear us right now. So,
well, hello to everyone who's coming on early. Thanks for coming on.
I keep looking back at my TV. I'm looking at it on my TV along with the broadcast.
So is Alan Stern your last guest? Is that right? He was on here last time?
As far as an Explore Now program, we do different programs, but Alan Stern was on. He's coming back on February 4th. We're doing a global star party where we have astronomers from around the world come on and they do like live views through telescopes. But this time it's the editorial staff of Astronomy Magazine, Alan Stern, who's going to talk from, you know, about Q&A on New Horizons. And then David Levy will be on, who personally knew Clyde Tombaugh and wrote basically his biography. And so it's celebrating the 115th birthday of Clyde Tombaugh, which is February 4th, and so it's going to be a great thing, you know. I know that you love planets and worlds and stuff. If you'd like to be on for that to celebrate some of that, that would be great, you know. So
I have to admit, I don't know too much about the history except for the names, obviously. Those characters involved, and I know that Alan has strong feelings about what happened to Pluto, and
they all do.
Yeah.
They all do. And I met Clyde Tombaugh at one point.
Oh wow.
So, probably because of that I do too, you know. So ultimately I think categorization and naming of things, it could be named, you know, Zizix, it could be anything, you know, it could be just a word, you know, so
a rose, you know, by any other name still smells as sweet, right?
Yes, that's right. So
people ask this a lot with moons.
Somehow calling it a dwarf planet made people feel bad about it somehow. So I don't know why.
I can see that.
I've hit upon the word world as a good description for all these bodies. You know, they're all worlds.
Yeah, they're worlds. Yeah.
Right. Yeah, I prefer that. Too. I prefer that as well. Yeah, we even did that in our paper where we classified different planets a few years ago. And rather than calling... our scale went all the way down to things which were like the mass of Iapetus, like really, really small objects, even the moons in the solar system. And some of those would not be big enough by some, you know, definitions to be called a planet. So we just called everything worlds, and it just sort of simplified the discussion, not to get into that.
Yeah, so we'll want to talk about the cool worlds program at Columbia and your outreach work too, and all of that. So it's going to be great. Let's
see. So you guys will have to give me some tips on astrophotography as well, because that's sort of becoming my new hobby at the moment.
Done.
No problem.
Oh, great. Yeah. I've written a couple books on scientific astrophotography and also perfect remote observatories that I can give you a link to look through.
Please.
A preview.
Yeah.
And please. Springer. So I'm also a series editor for Patrick Moore series of for practical astronomy books.
Mm.
So I know you published your book in Springer.
Yeah, you just bought the book, right?
Yeah, I'm gonna buy. I haven't paid for it yet. I just looked it up and found it, so I'm gonna buy it.
I have to admit that. I mean, that's literally just my thesis, but they mm-hmm. it was like a prize that they give each year where they pick the top theses from.
Oh, yeah, that's
the UK,
series,
I think. And
That's cool. I was glancing through it earlier.
Yeah, it's nice to be called an author in that sense, even though I really Didn't do anything extra to get that label.
It looks like it's listed as a textbook. The way they the way they present it on the Springer website it's under an e-textbook.
Well, hello, everyone. This is Scott Roberts with the special program of Explore Now with Dr. David Kipping. And we've been talking in the background. We're both Jerry Hubble and I are very excited to have him on the program. I've been trying to binge watch some of his social media videos and stuff like that. Jerry's been digging into his exoplanet and exomoon research and stuff. And David, we're really happy to have you on the program. So it's
great. Happy to be here.
I often sounds like you got all the, because I'm from this, I'm a 70s kid, so but I love your program Cool Worlds, and I need to do a little bit better introduction of you. Okay, I know that you studied in the UK. You came. You were studying also at Smithsonian, Harvard, with the Menzel program. Is that right?
That's right. It was the Sagan Fellowship and the Menzel Fellowship. I kind of had this kind of weird hybrid thing going on. But yeah, that's right.
And currently, and you mentioned that you've been at Columbia University for 5 years. You're an assistant professor at this point.
Correct. Yeah. Right?
And specializing in exomoons, which when Jerry first told me about this research, I was like, how in the world? Well put. How in the world does a guy go and, find a moon around an exoplanet, and so
he must be a lunatic.
Lunatic. That's right.
Right.
That's right. So, I am I'm very impressed by your research. I am equally impressed by the fact that you do educational public outreach. There's not every scientist does it as much as you do. And, and in talking to you before the show, we both have come to learn that you love this. You love explaining what you do and explaining the leading bleeding edge of exoplanet and exomoon discovery and research. And so I really thank you for being on the program. It's awesome. Thank you.
Like I said, it's my pleasure. As I was saying to you before, I love the chance to get to talk to someone about astronomy because no one else in this house wants to hear about me talk about exomoons. So if you guys are here, that's great. I get to get this off my chest.
Astronomers suffer from that too. Both the wife is into it. The husband rarely is like, oh my God, she's talking about space again or the planets again or astrophotography again or... Right. Yeah, same deal. It's rare. It really is rare when you have a married couple. They're both into something together like that. But anyhow, I'm sure she respects what you do, and and I'm sure likewise you respect what she does. I know
everyone
you're
has their thing. Yeah, I am. Yes, I've got two kids. So I was just kind of warning you that there is a chance. It's that time of the evening when they get pretty energetic. That they could be steaming in any time.
Yeah,
but hopefully they won't
see that. So, but I know that I asked Jerry to come on the program. Jerry has been doing exoplanet work with the Mark Slade Remote Observatory. He introduced. Diffused the diffuser method for photometry to get like millimag photometry of of an exoplanet. We demonstrated it live. Of course, we all talked about this earlier, but Jerry was the one that made me aware of you. So I'm pleasantly surprised you know, that especially after binge watching your videos and stuff, pleasantly surprised at how enthusiastic and how interesting you come across to the average person. So that's you know, it's kind of a mark of genius. I saw Stephen Hawking talk one time, okay, at Caltech, and I was expecting, you know, I'm not an astrophysicist, okay, but I was thinking I'm just going to sit here in the audience and just kind of bathe in the ambiance of all these scientists and astrophysicists and cosmologists and stuff. So mm-hmm. He was introduced, and Hawking was hilarious.
He
took all, you know, made anybody, a third grader could have understood, you know, the dynamics of a black hole once he was done. And then he had questions being asked by the audience, not the audience, the students at Caltech. Mm. And most of the students asked very straightforward questions. He read the questions, he answered them, and then he gets to this last question. And this, David, this question has got to be 2 pages long. It sounded really complex and everything, and I was going, oh, yeah. Wow. I wonder if how long that's going to take Hawking to answer. And he said, all this guy is asking is this, and he asked the question for him in just a few words, and then he answered it like in 5 words, okay? And he says, if you can't ask the question so that anybody can understand the question, you don't really understand it yourself. Mm-hmm. And of course, the audience erupted in laughter, I think you have the hallmarks of a great educator, you know, I'm sure that in history you're going to be one of the guys that goes down in history for helping us explore all these new worlds. I think it's very. Well,
that's an exceptionally generous introduction. I'll take it. You know, anything we can get, I'll take. But we stand on the shoulders of giants and those great communicators that have come before, such as Hawking and Sagan. Those people have been an inspiration to me to do what I'm doing with my communication efforts. And, you know, it's funny, you always think I'll never be anywhere near as good as those people, both intellectually or as a communicator. So I'm sure, but I kind of feel like everybody probably thinks that to some extent. I'm sure everybody has someone hanging up in their wall that they think I'll never be that, but it's nevertheless, it kind of inspires you to try.
Sure. Well, I did watch the video of where you found, that little mistake that Einstein made. So, you know, I think that was very interesting. And I just go, oh gosh, I can't wait to get this guy on the program. So, but
yeah, that was a fun
Jerry, I'm going to turn this over to you and let you and David interact here. And so thank you for coming on.
Thanks, Scott. Thanks, David, for coming.
Yeah,
it's great to be able to see you and talk to you after I discovered your paper. The one I've discovered was the one that was in December. Is that right? That was released. I got a pre-release version off archive in December. But you talk about this method of and I don't want to spend too much time, maybe 5 or 10 minutes, talking to you about the details of this because Scott's got a lot to talk to you about. Also, I don't want to waste your time. But I just had a couple of questions. It's very interesting to me, transit timing variations, just to give you a little, I'm into signal analysis also. I'm a retired nuclear instrumentation engineer, so I'm into measurements and stuff like that. And one of the things that struck me about your paper, and it struck a chord with me, is because I've done noise analysis techniques for doing, you know, response time measurements and other kinds of statistical measurements. And, so that's what really jazzes me about doing these high precision transit measurements, right? The photometry. And it struck me when I read your paper, the overview of it, and saw that you were using variations in the transit time that was really struck a chord with me. And I thought that was really cool that you're able to draw that extra data out of the transit time variation. And then you correlated it with the aliasing that was for the exomoons. That's pretty cool. So I just had a couple of questions about the cadence, about the what kind of precision do you need for the exposure time? And this relates to the size of the telescope and how much light you can gather and how fast you can take exposures. What do you think? And I'm looking at this from the aspect of an amateur astronomer, maybe trying to do some of this work. I don't know if it's possible or not, but it just struck me as something to try, you know. And I want to know what the cadence for the exposure times and what's your for the precision on the time. What kind of things are you looking at?
Yeah. So when we're trying to, I just give a quick background that when we're trying to measure a transit time for those who aren't exactly sure what I'm describing here. When the planet eclipses the star, blocks out some of the light, and it's really, we're measuring the central time of that event.
Right.
And if there's a moon around it, it should cause the planet to wobble a small amount due to the moon's gravity. And we are looking for that effect. The thing that was highlighted in this paper, as you rightly point out, Jerry, is to think about not just how big is this signal, but what does it look like, really? What is the shape of that signal? And in particular, I highlighted that these signals will always be kind of like trying to take a series of photos of a fast spinning wheel. The wheel is spinning too fast for your frame rate of your camera. And so you get this kind of stroboscopic aliasing effect. Mm. And the same thing happens for moons, actually. And that's kind of actually a useful property. It means that these signals will always have this particular property that we can look for. Now, in terms of measuring this effect, so really what you're doing is you need to measure a series of transits. The difficult thing, I think, for amateurs, before we get into the issues of exposure, cadence, things like that, is what type of planet are you going to look at? Now, to date, we have primarily focused on planets which live between about 1/10 of an AU out to about 1 AU. That's mostly because that's all we really had to play with. There were, of course, hot Jupiters closer in and hot Neptunes closer in. But our thinking was, let's not even look at those because they're so close to the star that even if they had once had moons in the past, the moons can only survive for a few million years. And that's just because of tidal evolution. So, of course, we all know the moon is moving away from us about 4 centimeters per year. And the region of stability around these hot Jupiters is so narrow that it barely takes a blink of an eye in cosmic timescale for these moons to escape out of that region because they're just so close to the star. Mm-hmm. So we really haven't looked at those. And so we focused at the longer period planets. And what that means observationally is that their periods are not once every 3 days, but more like once every month or even once every year. In fact, one of the planets that we're working on right now has a period of just over 2.5 years.
Wow.
That means you have to wait 2.5 years between every event, and you're looking for deviations in transit times. So that means that you can't just have 2 or 3. You need a battery of these things to look for
them. Right, right.
But so this could is take very, several very years. Patient work.
Yeah, several years.
You have to
years.
Look for a long time. Mm-hmm. And of course, the other side effect of that, if you do think that long period planets are the way to go, which is my personal opinion at the moment, just because you look at Mercury and Venus, you don't see moons. But once you get out to about an AU, all the planets have moons beyond that point.
Mm-hmm.
So if you work with that logic, it actually puts over another problem for amateur astronomers and for ground-based astronomers in general. And that's that because these planets are moving so slowly in their orbits at longer distances, the transits don't take an hour or two like we're used to for hot Jupiters. They take sometimes 20, 30 hours to go in front of their star.
Right.
And there's just no way you can catch it unless you live on, you know, the North Pole or something, and you're watching it during the Arctic winter.
Right.
And then, of course, you've got very challenging conditions, but it's just basically impossible to catch these things. So that's why we, in my team, have focused on space-based observatories, because they're the only things in town that can do that. The only way around this would be to have a longitudinal network. Of course, you could maybe do something like this. You have a series of telescopes spread out across the world, and each one catches just a bit of the transit. That could work, but it would require very skillful calibration between those observatories, of course, because
right.
if you have a 30-hour transit, You could have like a 4-hour chunk from one observatory here and then the next 4-hour chunk, but they're both in the dip of the transit. And so it's very difficult to align things precisely because there isn't any variation happening between these two. So this is why this work's very challenging to do from the ground. It's not impossible, but it's just far, far more difficult than doing hot Jupiter work. Now, yes. the only benefit I would say of this, to come back to your question of cadence and exposure, is the only real constraint I would say for transit timing is that you want to resolve the ingress and egress. You need to have sufficient time sampling to capture those. For hot Jupiter, that can be of order of 10, 15 minutes. And that can be quite tricky to capture. If you're doing a 10-minute exposure, that's too long. You're just going to get a blurred out smudge.
Right.
On those edges. So you need fast exposures, which means you need a really big aperture. And so it gets hard. The benefit of looking at the long period planets is actually the ingress and egress can last for 2 or 3 hours. So that offers distinct challenges, but some benefits in other ways.
Right. So what you just said kind of brought something to mind is, so would it be good enough and to just measure the ingress and egress and then calculate the midpoint time based on just that, if you just observe those portions?
That's certainly the most important part of the information to capture. I guess the problem is that you really need to make sure that you see the flat bit before the ingress starts and the flat bit after the ingress stops. So then you can truly measure where the midpoint of that ingress is, because that's really what you want. And then you can draw a line between the two midpoints. Of course, the issue comes in with statistical uncertainties here, because of course, the less baseline you have, then the noisier your inference will be, because that's your calibration data essentially. So the less calibration data you have, the worse your inference is going to be. You can still do it. It's still possible to make progress, but you're just going to end up with a bigger error bar than someone who could just stare at it all the time.
Right. So, for example, the way we do it today as an amateur is to get a full transit, you typically start an hour's worth of baseline before the ingress, and then you have an hour after the ingress. So you could almost chop this up to where you have an hour before the ingress, and then an hour after it gets to the bottom. And assuming this, it's fairly flat. It may not be flat. It depends on the planet, of course, but and how what the inclination. But so that's a technique that we might be able to use, it seems like. And the
you could probably help yourself by using a red filter as well, of course. But then you kill some of them darting, and then you you'd get something a bit flatter post ingress as well.
The other thing is that since these transits take so long to come around, they're the longer period planets, then you could do a survey. I have a list of planets that you would survey every year, maybe 30, 40 planets, if you could get that many observations in, and then just cycle through them.
Yeah.
As they come along, I guess.
I agree with that. I mean, the thing is with one of our first exomoon, well, it's the only exomoon candidate really, is Kepler 1625. It has a period of 287 days. Mm-hmm. So if you miss one, you have to wait a long time. It's really frustrating as an observer to wait 9 months to get the transit. And we actually applied to, when we wrote our paper, we made a clear prediction. We said, look, if this moon is real, we made a claim there was a moon, but it was just a candidate. We said, if this moon is real, we can predict where the moon will be next time we look. It was like May 2019 or May 2020, I can't remember the year, but we had a clear prediction. It should happen before the planetary transit. So the moon will come in, there'll be a flat line, and then the planet will come in. And Hubble could observe this thing. And if it lands, not only do we see the dip again, but in the dip, in the location where we predict it to happen, we're done. It is a proven exomoon at that point.
Mm-hmm.
And we thought we had a really strong case. And so we asked Hubble, could we do it? They said no. We tried to scramble some ground-based observers to catch the ingress. We used there's like a 4-meter telescope somewhere, actually not sure which one it was now, one of my collaborators used, and even then it was we got just like a partial, because the clouds came in, we got like a partial ingress and it was couldn't really do much with it. So it's very frustrating, because then we're like, okay, now we have to wait 9 months again before we can do anything. And it turned out, when you look 9 months ahead, our prediction had basically become too noisy then. So I can't even tell you where I expect the moon to be in 9 months right, time because the error bars get too big. And so we're kind of stuck in this situation where like we have to go back to the drawing board again on this guy now.
Right, and do an initial observation again, right, yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So what I want to say in terms of this is that all of these long period transiting planets, of which there's hardly any, there's really just a few dozen of the things, they are all very precious, very, very precious objects, and they hardly ever transit. And so when they do, it's almost like a lunar eclipse in some respects. It's like, it's a very special astronomical event that I would encourage everybody who can to try and get some data of those things, because otherwise you're waiting 2 or 3 years to see it again.
Right, right.
Right. Wow.
That's great.
So, very difficult to do. Can take a long time to get this data. Even so, with these long periods, how many final candidates that do you have that you can say, yeah, that's an exomoon?
We only really have one. There was, I don't want to give any spoilers because we're working on something new, but there's only one that's published.
And you're about to make this announcement.
There's only one that's published. So there's one published, and there was actually someone did publish recently. They published, they thought there was six more around in Kepler data. And I had a look at those and I disagreed. I wrote a paper that said, actually, I don't think any of these are exomoons when you look at the variations more carefully. Mm. It is really fickle and tricky work. And, you know, even for the one that we have claimed, Kepler 1625, three teams have looked at it, including ourselves, and two of them agree that it's there. Hmm. And one team disagrees. And one team thinks the signal isn't robust and they don't get the same signal we get. So even in that one case, there's still some controversy associated with it, which is of course why I want to get more data. I mean, that's the only way to really resolve these things.
Are these are pretty much Kepler stars, is that right, that you're looking at as candidates for the long
period?
It is period?
For the moment. I really hope that will change soon, just because, you know, as you know,
TESS has got longer term, right,
and sure. It's observing much brighter stars, right. And so we can potentially really, really make progress from the ground. And of course, especially the M dwarf stars it's observing has way more M dwarf stars. And the nice thing about M dwarfs is I always think it's like Honey, I Shrunk the Kids with these things. So the entire planetary system shrinks down. And so if you go to the Habitable Zone, for instance, rather than going all the way out to a 365 day period, you can be looking at something that's like 20, 30 days. And so then it kind of resolves some of these problems. And the thing is, that's also true for exomoon stability. So if you go around the sun, because the sun's got greater mass, of course, at a 30-day orbital period, which is pretty tight in, interior to Mercury's orbit, you can't really hold on to moons. But for a late M-dwarf star like Proxima Centauri or TRAPPIST, that's game on. You can easily hold on to large moons at those distances. So everything's more accessible potentially with those stars. Of course, they're fainter. And so that's why TESS is, you know, so exciting, because it's hopefully going to give us the catalog of the brightest end of those objects. And we're not quite there yet. We don't have the catalog still being established and built up. But I'm really excited for the future of exomoon hunting, and especially those compact M dwarf systems with TESS.
That's pretty exciting. I mean, it's just amazing. Just when I first observed my first transit, it's been three, four years ago now. Almost. That was pretty exciting when you're able to make that measurement. And then when I read the paper about the engineered diffuser system and then tried it out and got it and actually got the precision that I really expected, you know, and you'll see in my paper, I gave you the link to it. You'll see we got down to a total precision of around one millimag, 1.5 millimag, something like that.
That's impressive. What was your cadence?
So that was a bend measurement, you know. So the paper talks about standard bending of 30 minutes and then, of course, the 5-minute bend. So with a 5-minute bend, I can get down to like three to four millimag.
Yeah,
which is about three times better than normal amateur, you know, defocus method, or, you know, it is the best you can do right now without the diffuser. But there's a lot of scintillation noise that I was able to, the diffuser really corrects a lot of issues that you have in the back, in a normal backyard. You know, it's one thing to do these measurements up on top of a mountain, but if you're in a normal back suburban backyard trying to do these precision measurements, you know, you got a lot to deal with, and that's kind of what's neat about the diffuser. You know, it corrects some of these issues. That's
interesting. I'm looking forward to reading that. That's a very impressive level of precision indeed. Yeah. So if you're achieving that, then you can actually do some interesting exoplanet work, I think.
It always impresses me that that you meet amateur astronomers that, you know, can overcome a lot of obstacles and a lot of difficulties, you know, in order to get some data. Sometimes it's not the very best data, but there's a lot of us amateur astronomers that have a lot of telescope time, a lot of instrument time. And so, you know, I always look forward to, you know, I cheer on organizations like the AAS and the AAVSO and Association of Lunar and Planetary Observers, because they're all involved in, you know, participating and encouraging PROAM collaborations, you know, so, and I think that Jerry has done a little, you know, his part in popularizing exoplanet work by amateurs. So, you know, I look forward to the day when, you know, we can turn to 500 amateur astronomers to confirm something, you know, that professionals have detected and just need confirmation. So,
But I think TESS offers a great opportunity. I mean, the very fact of its observing strategy is that it leaves, stares at the field, then it goes off and it doesn't come back for, you know, 12 months or 24 months. So there's a huge gap in our data sets where having some additional data would really help, especially if you see a TESS planet that has a longish period in that it's only been observed, say, two times, then we really don't know hardly anything about its orbital period. I mean, you can just draw a straight line between those two times and say that's the orbital period. But what if it has a 1% transit timing variation, which is actually very common? Then, you know, you could observe it one night, not see anything, and you might think, well, I screwed something up. But if you can exclude that the planet didn't transit when it should have done, that means you have a dynamically active system. And that's really interesting. You've basically detected TTVs by virtue of the fact you didn't detect the planet when it should have been going across the star, assuming you didn't screw anything up. So there's a lot of, you know, those systems with very sparse information, those two transitors, I think they're just calling out for people to follow them up.
Yeah, I would agree with that. And hopefully, you know, new methods and new techniques can come about so that we can get more amateurs to discover these things. But there is big challenges, as you did point out, about these long periods and the need for big aperture and those types of things. One of the opportunities sometimes is that amateurs can get on larger instruments. You know, the pros are trying to get on the best instruments. You know, there's a lot of mid-range apertures out there that are relatively unused, you know, even at like Mount Wilson with the 100-inch out there, they're trying to figure out ways to use that instrument again to do research. The last research I saw done on it was the a stellar program that had been going on, the HK project, which had been going on for, I don't know, 90 years or 100 years or something like that, where they had these this data set going on. When I was there, they had just installed a kind of a home-built system to sharpen the stars with active optics, you know. And, you know, there's old big observatories, the aperture's there. You can throw on some nice cameras, maybe some newer filters and and the with volunteers that will help you out, that maybe they're retired researchers or whatever. But I think there's some potential there. When I was at Mauna Kea for doing the eclipse, it was, you know, I saw the competitiveness of professional astronomers wanting to be, you know, hoping to be on Keck. Keck wasn't built yet in 91 when I was there. Definitely got to understand that at a level that I just didn't expect, you know, the kind of competition there was in the professional world. So, but I understand it better now. I did want to ask you some questions about your work right now at Columbia University, and then I kind of want to do this in reverse. I want to find out about your early life, your early interest in science.
Sure.
Yeah, and so, but let's find out about Columbia now and what you're doing there.
Yeah, so I work on a diverse range of topics within broadly the field of exoplanets and astrobiology even as well. I am most well known for the exomoon stuff because there's hardly anyone who does that. So I think that already is sort of my claim to fame, if you will, that people tend to know me for that. But I guess the downside looking for exomoons, even though it has been a passion and certainly astronomy, my passion for astronomy has never wavered throughout the years. But I have to say, when you run a big survey, which we have been doing for exomoons for a long time, that can be quite exhausting, because especially when it's just a series of no results. We've published like over 100 no results in different papers. So that's kind of hard to sometimes keep going on those projects. So
right.
I always say to my students, good advice, I think, is to find other things within, you know, intellectually that can fill you up, and doesn't even have to be astronomy. For some of my students, you know, it could be like playing Dungeons and Dragons or something. Or for others, you know, I actually spent a lot of time reading Tolkien and diving into the lore of Tolkien's universe. So I think having other things to intellectually engage you is great. And for me, in terms of research, statistics has been an ever-growing part of my interest. Mm-hmm. And the application of statistics, and particularly in cases where you hardly know anything. And because that's almost the perverse case. I mean, most people think of statistics, they might think of like big data, where you have huge data sets from like Facebook or LinkedIn of like people's behavior and patterns. And honestly, it's not that hard to work with big data, because the data tells you what the answers are very straightforwardly. And in astronomy, we would love to have big data, because it really guides you as to what the answer is without any prejudice. The harder regime, and the one less well touched, and perhaps why I'm interested in it for that reason, is what do you do when you just have like one data point or just like one crappy measurement, and you're trying to infer something quite deep from that? So an example might be life emerged on the Earth pretty quickly. What does that tell us about the frequency of life in the universe?
Right.
Now, there's an instinctive reaction to say it teaches you nothing, because it's one data point. One data point equals nothing. But that's immediately wrong, because zero data points is no data. One data point is data. There is something there. It's just not a lot. It's very, very little. And so it demands a very high level of scrutiny and interrogation and care with how you deal with that one data point. Mm-hmm. If I had 1,000 exoplanets where I discovered life, it'd be pretty straightforward to calculate the odds of life. I just would have to just simply count them up, and that'd be the end of it. It's much harder when you only have one, and especially when your existence is predicated upon that being a success in the first place. Mm-hmm. Like, we wouldn't be here had life not got going.
Right. Now, so it seems to me that you're talking about, you're really leaning on all the other information around that. What caused life to occur here, and why is it universal, right? That's what you're kind of getting after, is that right? And why those rules are kind of in place in terms of physics and biology, this is kind of bounds the problem. And then once you find one instance of it, then you can make assumptions about it. Is that what you're thinking about?
That's certainly an approach that many of my colleagues are pursuing along those directions. I'd say my approach is somewhat slightly different, although it does still have bounds and other information. So the information I'm really interested in, I read a paper about this last year that was published in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences. Mm-hmm. And in that, I tried to calculate the odds of life emerging on an Earth-like planet and intelligence re-emerging on an Earth-like planet. And I was just using chronology. So just literally timing how long it took for these events to happen on the Earth. And there's also a time at the very beginning and the very end that is often ignored, which is, when did the Earth become habitable? When did the oceans emerge? We can use that from geological evidence. We sort of have evidence when the oceans emerged about 4.4 billion years ago. But also, how long is left? Because it's actually only about a billion years left on the clock, actually a bit less than that, 0.9 billion years, before the sun's evolution gets sufficiently warmer that it basically ends up shutting down the carbon cycle on the Earth. So the carbon cycle is kind of like a thermostat that keeps the Earth's temperature basically more or less the same. If you increase the temperature on the Earth, it increases precipitation and weathering. And as you increase precipitation, rain, that rain dissolves carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere mm-hmm. and turns into carbonic acid. And that eventually then gets turned into rock underneath the surface of the Earth. So there's this balance. Whenever you increase the temperature, the Earth wants to push the CO2 levels back down, and vice versa. Whenever the CO2 goes up, you get this kind of thermostat balancing effect. So there's a point, though. Eventually, there's no CO2 left. And we worry about climate change in the near term, that we're putting too much CO2 in the atmosphere. But in the billion years, we'll have the opposite problem. As the sun warms up the Earth more and more, what's going to happen is all the CO2 will get pulled out of the atmosphere into through precipitation and dissolving into carbonic acids. And we'll be CO2 starved, and plants will die as a result of that process. At least that is the prediction from planetary scientists in about 0.9 billion years, running their climate models into the future. So that's kind of interesting, because it means that we emerged pretty late. I mean, I think astronomers tend to think, oh, there's like 5 billion years left. The sun's middle-aged.
Oh, right.
And so we tend to think that we're Copernican-like, like in the middle of time. We're actually not in the middle of time. We're actually kind of in the last chapter of the book. And that really struck a chord with me and was like, that's interesting. What is this telling us? Does it tell us anything about the occurrence rate of intelligence evolution on Earth-like planets? And so, to give you the sort of the snap conclusion of this very careful Bayesian analysis that I did, I think there is optimism that life starts frequently, given how quickly it started on the Earth. We find a 9-1 betting odds. So if you went to the cosmic bookies, went to the cosmic casino, and you were going to place bets on either life is rare or life is common. I'm not going to quantify exactly what I mean by that, but some life is doesn't happen hardly ever, or life is basically all over the place. I would put 9-1 odds that life is all over the place. But for intelligence, we're actually pessimistic. And that's really driven by the fact it took as long as it did. If intelligence evolution was such a straightforward and easy process, it's kind of remarkable that it took as long as it did, and it happened just before the clock stopped.
Yeah.
And so it's not quite as strong as the 9-1 odds, but we find 3-2 odds, a gentle nudge that intelligence might be rare, even though life might be common. So obviously 3-2 odds isn't much to bet your house on. And so, of course, this is why we need to do SETI. We need to look for, we need to certainly keep looking. I would never say my result basically solves the problem,
right.
But it does nudge us towards this idea that maybe a simple resolution to the Fermi paradox is just, it doesn't happen that often.
Yeah, right. Yeah. I would probably be in the camp that some sort of life exists like cockroaches throughout the universe. I would say that what we call intelligent life is rare. Super intelligent life, I wonder, We're on the verge right now of taking artificial intelligence to the point of where, it's super artificial intelligence. And, in talking to people that discuss the idea of us visiting life somewhere else, Seth Shostak at SETI, I think, is in the camp that if we've ever been visited, we've been visited by artificial intelligence, you know? And so, but that's getting off on another tangent. It's not a rarity anymore for me to talk to a scientist that does not think that there's life elsewhere in the universe. If we went to the Jet Propulsion Laboratory, almost all the people involved in planetary science will tell you that they absolutely are, you know, in the camp that there's not only life out there, but we're going to go find it, you know. And so that is the research that's going on with Mars and, you know.
You hear that a lot. And all I'd say to that is I would really encourage everybody to keep a very open mind. There is an effect known in psychology for a long time and other fields as well of experimenter's bias. When the experimenter thinks they know what the answer is, they tend to get that answer even when it's not real. In every piece of noisy gray data, you know, almost like a Rorschach, you think you're seeing something that's not there. And so I would, whatever your personal beliefs, I'd say when you're actually trying to do the act, the scientific act of asking this question, I think we have to remain on board with the possibility we might be alone. And if you don't, what's the point in doing the experiment? If you're assuming you know the answer before you do it, there's really no point in doing the experiment at all. Right. And I would hate us to bias our perspective because we think we're smarter than we are. And I hope I kind of personally hope that there are others out there. But I do try to remain as neutral as possible about it in my scientific approach, because I don't think it's helpful to walk in with prejudgments.
Right. And so that's a scientist's mind. That is trying to be someone that is unbiased it takes a very special type of psychology. I think it takes a... I think it's something that can be learned, but I think it also takes a special kind of person that is willing to be this unbiased kind of individual, you know, in a world of biased people. So as you were going through your education, through your life experiences and all the rest of it, what would you say, for stepping back into maybe some of your earlier educational experiences, maybe even before you entered into university, what kind of qualities, how did these qualities manifest in you? How did you become this person that... I sense that you're someone that challenges other established science, what someone might call, you know, as Jerry talks about, is settled science or scientific fact. To me, I always get very excited by seeing science really at work, where they're challenging. They're not saying, yes, okay, all of Einstein's writings are not solid fact here. They can be challenged. We can question them. Okay. You've done that. What do you think that is something that is learned? Is that something inherited? Is that something that, taught? How do you get there? How do you become a scientist, a real scientist?
It's hard to give a complete answer to that, of course, and I'm not a social scientist, so I'm not sure I know the answer. I can only speak anecdotally to my own experiences.
Yeah, your own experience, right?
Yeah, I've always been interested in space and science, and even I think my first real interest kind of was kickstarted when my parents, when I was like 5 or 6 years old, bought me an annual of space with an astronaut on the front and pictures of the planets. And I remember studying learning the masses, like three or four decimal places of each of those planets. I don't know why, I just would dream about them all the time. It really captivated me. And When I was having a bad day at school or something, or you know, whatever, I would often lie in the grass and just stare at the stars on a warm summer evening. That was, and just dream. And I was a big Star Trek fan, so I used to imagine what it was like to explore the galaxy and, you know, be with Captain Kirk, whatever, flying between the stars. So all of those things definitely were always with me in terms of my fascination with space and the stars. Uh-huh. When I got a bit older, I say, you know, in terms of like questioning things, I think my dad helps with that as well, because me and him, we argue constantly. So it's just like, for us, that's like a sport, you know, we just love debating. It's like the argument shop in Monty Python. We always joke about that. We just go off on one about anything. We can have an hour long argument. So I think that kind of helps a little bit, actually, having some training in debate.
Sure.
And then as I got older, I had a very influential teacher at my school. I was lucky to have that, who was, you know, trained in physics, and mm-hmm. He was like always giving me books, you know, about particle physics or quantum physics, you know, on the side, like, you should check this out, Kipping, have a look at this. And that, you know, that someone believed in me, I guess. And that, yeah, that helped, you know, to feel like someone trusts in you and eggs you on. And then, you know, he told me when I was applying to college, if I could go back in time, I'd do astronomy, not physics, because physics is at a point where we don't know everything, but it's getting harder and harder to make progress. Whereas astronomy, we're never going to run out of things to study astronomy. It's just the sort of improvements in technology are opening that up at a much faster rate than other fields of physics. Mm-hmm. And so that got me excited about it. And even though my degree was in physics, in the last year of my degree, I really gravitated more and more towards astronomy for similar reasons. You know, I was learning about CERN and the Higgs boson and stuff, and it just was kind of depressing how 10,000 people had to work to like make that happen.
Right.
And then you're reading astronomy papers where like one person had just discovered the first transiting planet or something like this. It was just like, whoa, this is more like a wild west of discovery out there. And that was exciting to me. Right. So
probably will be for a long time, you know.
And that's why it's open to amateurs too. That's a big reason amateurs can contribute, because the sky is open to everybody. It's not just, you don't have to build a $10 billion machine to study the stars.
Yeah, it's egalitarian. It doesn't care, you know, too much about, whether there's some constraints about geographically, I suppose, but anyone can really do it. And everyone can look up and be inspired by the sky, certainly. So, I mean, one of my first papers came from hiking in the Himalayas. I sometimes talk about this to my students, kind of a fun story. And I was in Ladakh in the northeast of India, doing some mountaineering. And I had this plan to climb this mountain. I went up there, I actually injured myself. I got altitude sickness, I hurt my knee, and I spent all my money trying to climb this mountain, and I failed. And I felt so miserable about failing. And I went back down to the city, had a couple of weeks to recover. And then I thought, I'm just going to try again. So even though I had zero money this time. So I went back, I climbed it. I couldn't afford the permits and I couldn't afford a guide. But I felt like I sort of knew my way the second time.
Now you know you don't want to.
And I went up and I had
to
avoid
to do this stuff, right?
So. You do. I wouldn't do it now, I have to say. And I had to avoid the route because they were checking the permits on the route. So I had to go around everybody and camp by myself. And I took my time this time. I think I rushed too much the first time, and that's why I get altitude sickness. So I was just ascending, I think like 800 meters in altitude a day or something. Just not trying to like push too hard. Just do a slow expedition.
Sure.
I remember I had one loaf of bread for like a five day expedition. That was all my food I had, was one
this
loaf of
the
bread.
This is the whole story.
It was pretty miserable. But I also had a journal, and in my journal I was like, what am I doing each day? But of course there wasn't much to say. It was like, well, I walked in the morning and got to here, and that was the end of it. But then I'd spend ages in the back of the journal thinking about astronomy in space.
Oh yeah.
And I pretty much wrote my first paper just in the tent. And it was, what is the transit duration of a planet which goes on an elliptical orbit? And remarkably, pretty much no one had really calculated that to the proper degree of accuracy that was necessary. And I think it was because people basically assumed, hey, look at the solar system. Everything goes around in circles. Exoplanets are bound to do that. And to me as a young person, I was like, no, it's not going to be like that. Everything's going to be wild and crazy out there. And it turned out that was right. And it ended up being one of my most well-cited papers that I sort of sketched in the back of a journal just with too much time on my hands hiking in the Himalayas. So it's strange in that. And then when you get a success like that, you know, success bestows success. You get encouraged by those little successes and it makes you have confidence in yourself that you can go further and harder. And then I start thinking maybe I can take on this exomoon problem. So yeah, I think that kind of gets us almost up to speed as to where I am now. And there's no singular events. Life is a series of these little things that nudge you towards where you end up.
So you have your students with the challenge of trying to work on these exomoons, and as hard as it is, and you were saying, you know, it's so difficult to get a confirmation, solid confirmation that we've got one. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
How do you keep them engaged? I mean, I can tell you're kind of managing them. You're saying, hey, look at, you know, think of other ways you can use your intelligence. Keep yourself going. But, in order to make something happen, I know that some scientists work their whole lives till they get something, you know, or sometimes they work their whole lives and they don't realize the culmination of something. You know, it's just their data is used later. You know, what do you think keeps a scientists and students like that? You know, their drive? I mean,
there's a couple of things that. I mean, one is that this is obviously shaped by my own experience as well. That when I was hired as a professor at Columbia, I mean, I'm sure many people out there know this, that getting hired is such an outrageously competitive job. There's like 300 applicants to one position. It's really crazy. But so I didn't have an exomoon to point at and say, look, I've been looking for exomoons for 5 years, but I haven't found any. Yeah. So how the hell did I get hired? I mean, that doesn't really make sense on paper. Hmm. I would claim that perhaps the reason is because I was trying to do this thing that no one else was doing. I had to invent all of the tools and I had to more or less become an expert in all sorts of things. I had to become an expert in the observations, the data analysis, the instrumentation, the statistical techniques, modeling of exoplanet light curves, dynamics. So I ended up with this like very broad skill set because I was just teaching myself all this stuff to be able to get to the goal of exomoons. And I didn't realize at the time I was teaching myself these things. But then when I turned up, you know, for the interview, I suppose, I was probably much better equipped than most of the other candidates just because I was doing what, you know, I basically knew all these different fields as a virtue of having that goal. So sometimes the goal...
Hey, this guy's got some tools already and he's thought about this deeply. And I think that most of us, I mean, way before we had confirmation of exoplanets. I mean, it's not a new idea that we would have it. You know, there is a lot of understanding that processes that happen here on Earth happen in other areas in our solar system. I'm sure that there's the occasional rarefied process that doesn't happen in our environment that we do see out there in our solar system or in space. Mm-hmm. It seems to me, and it seemed to me for a long time that, yeah, of course we're going to find planets around other stars. I just knew it was an eventuality. And well, if there's planets out there, there's moons out there and there's asteroids out there and there's comets out there, you know? So these are all, I think, all normal things in a solar system.
Yeah. Exactly. So you kind of knew in the back of your mind, if you keep going with this, you're going to reach, eventually we'll get there. But I guess moreover, what I was really trying to allude to that sometimes, you know, if you shoot for the sky or shoot for the moon and you reach the sky, that's still pretty good. And you're still probably a lot higher up than the other people who just shot for the top of that ladder. So sometimes having like lofty goals really forces you to go quite far with, you know, pushing yourself and your expertise. And then with my students, I have to say, you know, I like students who are passionate about their projects. So I always try to find each of them different projects. And only one of my students has ever worked on exomoons. The other ones, they all work on completely different topics, with, you know, usually within exoplanets, but different things. So you know, Emily Sanford, who is working with me, has been looking at the application of linguistics, natural language processing, to pattern recognition in exoplanets. If you see, you know, a sequence of planets like Mercury, Venus, Earth, how well can you predict the next one will be Mars? And we're sort of using these pattern recognition algorithms coming from NLP to see how well that works. And that, I mean, that's just a wild, fun idea that we've just enjoyed doing. We both enjoy it because we like learning new things. I didn't know anything about natural language processing beforehand.
From a different perspective. Yeah. Entirely,
but it forces me to open up the textbook and learn it. And so I like problems where I'm forced to learn. And then Moya McTeer, me and her, we cooked up this crazy idea to, could we ever set mountain ranges on an exoplanet? What would it take? And that's because of my love of mountains and mountain climbing. So I was like, what would it take to ever do that? So, you know, they all have ambitious, lofty goals in different directions. I guess maybe, hopefully they get that from me. But certainly I think it's important to have ownership of your thing. Like, this is my thing and this is what I want to be known for. Yeah.
There were, if I look, I thank you for all that and kind of opening yourself up to talking about your childhood and your influences from your family and your teachers. We had some questions here in our audience. One of the persons was asking about stellar information. And the question had to do with neutron stars. I cautioned him. I said, you know, that, you know, David is a, you know, a specialist in exoplanets, and I don't know what your thoughts are on neutron stars. And let me see if I can find the question.
Well, we do. Yeah, we are kind of interested in neutron stars. And do they have planets? Can we detect them using the methods we look for planets?
Sure.
In similar ways. They're kind of, I mean, they're not that different in terms of size. They're like a small planet, really.
Right, right. I will find it here. I have one. He said, concerning neutron stars, what force decides when neutron stars become a pulsar or a magnetar? And I did not know that, you know, that is more about stellar evolution. And don't know.
Well, I think. Again, this is my area of expertise. My understanding is that basically all the neutron stars are pulsars. It's just that the radio, it's thought that almost all of them have radio beams coming out their poles. It's just that we don't always align with them. So you're only gonna call it a pulsar if you see those radio pulses at the top and the bottom, like a lighthouse beacon spinning around, actually cross your line of sight. If they don't cross your line of sight, you never know they're there.
Never know.
So right. I think the magnetars, I'm not sure about, but I think for pulsars, they're kind of, tepid assumption is that almost all of them are pulsars, just to somebody else's point of view.
This is a question from Mike Wiesner. He says, from a detectability perspective, how do you decide whether it's a moon versus a twin planet?
Yeah, I mean, I'd say that's almost not an issue of detectability, but an issue of nomenclature. And we were kind of talking about this before we got started about Planet Nine and Pluto and all this debacle of naming and things. How big would the moon have to be before you call that a binary planet or a twin planet? Right. I mean, I don't really care that much about that question. I'm not that interested in arguments about naming. How much do you have to shrink down the Earth before we'd stop calling that a planet anymore?
Right.
Some people, I have to say, just give you a little bit of insight into this. Some people would say, well, it's the center of mass. If the center of mass is inside the planet, as it is for the Earth-Moon system, then that is a moon and not a binary planet. I don't really like that definition because the moon is moving away from us. And so the center of mass is pulling out. And so eventually, even though the physical dimensions of the Earth and the moon will not change, nor its orbit around the sun will change, the moon will just magically one day become a binary planet by this definition. So that just, something about that kind of bugs me, that it's too fluid, that it would just transition like that. I kind of want something that's more like, you know, it would just stay that way for the cosmic eons of time.
Well, like, but the mass ratio between the two bodies or something. Maybe it's a limit for the mass ratio or something.
Yeah, but then I guess even then it would just be arbitrary, right? So let's say we call it 10%. I mean, but it's just completely arbitrary that you'd choose that number. I suspect nature make, I don't think there's probably any breaks. I think nature probably makes 1% mass moons a lot of the time, 10% mass moons less often, and 50% mass moons hardly ever, but there'll be some of them as well. And it's just, I suspect, my guess is there'll be a continuum. There won't be some sharp divot.
Right. I guess the big thing is whether they, what's the practical impact of the binary planet in terms of the behavior or characteristics of the system? That would really be your defining point, I guess, in terms of whether life emerged on it, maybe, or whether it didn't emerge on it, or some things like that, you know.
Well, I guess, I mean, almost to take a step back is how do you even make a binary planet? And the one idea about how you might make such a thing is this idea called tidal capture. So if you have two planets which are forming in the circumstellar disk, if they get too close to each other, the tidal forces could actually capture them around one another. And so you could really end up with two Jupiters stuck together like that way. At least we can in simulations produce such things. And then you might think, well, surely those don't exist because we would have seen them. But the problem is they're basically invisible because the tidal capture mechanism works only, gravity only really gets strong when things are really close together. So it turns out that you can only form these binaries almost on top of each other. And so the thing basically looks like a single planet transiting in front of the star. It's really hard to distinguish that it's not just one double Jupiter-sized planet versus two Jupiters slightly separated away from each other. So we're actually working on that in my team right now. We think we have an idea as to how to break that degeneracy, but it's actually quite challenging to say. We don't know that there are no binary planets out there because of this problem.
But I can see where it's something that you wouldn't pay much attention to, or might make you feel a bit uneasy, because to think of just the concept or the naming of a binary planet is kind of fixing things. And this thought process that once you kind of fix something in your mind, a bunch of things get fixed, you know? And you lose the fluidity of change, you know, that happens. Right. So, and so I think that's something to always keep in mind.
It's hard to resist. Astronomers love classifying things, so it's hard for us to resist.
That's always the way it's going to be. Now let's move on to the next thing, because that's going to explain everything else, okay? But that's not going to explain everything else. This is, you know, probably the most interesting thing is that we're just in a constant flux and constant change. And that makes other people feel uneasy, you know, that they can't find something that's hard and definable, you know, to give them comfort. I guess, you know, so.
Just as a final thought on that, I kind of suspect it's the same thing with life, that there isn't a thing of non-life and life. I suspect it's a continuum of chemical networks, and it becomes very gray and difficult to say what is alive, what is not alive, and true probably even for intelligence.
Yes, I would agree with that too. Let's see. Andrew Corkill is asking, what is the future of exoplanet work? Where is it going? Will there be an exoplanet telescope on the moon, for example?
So there's lots of plans for new observatories. It is one of the hot areas in astronomy still, for sure. We're kind of, much to the angst of our colleagues of cosmologists and galaxy, you know, people, they don't like the fact we get so much telescope time and so much resources, but it is hot, and lots of graduate students and the public are very interested in this subject. So there's a lot of investment happening. Probably the telescope we're most interested in the short term is James Webb, which will hopefully fly towards the end of the year. That's the plan. And that will be kind of game changing for atmospheric science. So I think the study of exoplanet atmospheres has emerged to a point where it's almost 50% of the field, to some extent, is now just studying the atmospheres of these planets. Very, very popular amongst especially students coming up at the moment. James Webb promises the ability potentially to even have the sensitivity to detect biosignatures, the signs of life on certain, it has to be a very, very nice target. You're talking about, you know, one of the very nearest stars, very bright with a kind of plum Earth-like planet around it. But it is not out of the question that it could do that kind of work, or at least, you know, put constraints on the upper limits of, you know, very active oxygenated environments. It might be able to say that's not happening. So that's exciting. Of course, it could do lots for exomoons as well. I mean, to me, exomoons is completely untouched. We know 4,500 exoplanets, mm-hmm. and like half an exomoon, basically, like one candidate. So this diversity we've seen amongst exoplanets, imagine the diversity we're going to see amongst exomoons, given what's in our backyard. It's going to be off the scale.
The diversity of the moons that we have in our own solar system. So.
Right. So I don't understand why more people aren't excited about exomoons. It's my own bias, but to me, I think we're going to discover wonders and magnificent surprises amongst those things once we start doing it. Mm-hmm. And then going forward, we're thinking about building, you know, new missions after James Webb, not on the moon, not really for exoplanets, you know, but certainly radio telescopes are being planned on the moon for other types of science. Exoplanet science tends to not really work in the radio too much. But, you know, there's this telescope called Louvois that you can read about, or HabEx, which are, again, sort of doing what this life-finding task, but for way more stars. So they should be able to survey hundreds of planets rather than just maybe one that's really nice and close by. They could actually do a proper survey of a lot of Earth-like planets to look for life. But they're very expensive missions. You're talking probably of order of $20 billion in some cases to fund those things. So a huge amount of money. And to some degree, astronomy is hitting this point where we're sort of questioning, even against inflation, these big missions are eating up more and more and more money. Sure. And how sustainable is this? Because at this rate, we're sort of going to be eating up the entire NASA budget on one telescope at this rate within sort of a few decades. And some of us are concerned about that maybe this isn't the best approach to put all of our eggs in a single basket. But then how do you do these hard questions if you don't build these giant telescopes? It's a difficult problem.
And yeah, having students overall, we just need to add more money to our science budgets worldwide. You know, I think that it's important instead of adding more money to, I don't know, like defense, for example. You know, so sure. Right.
Students, it's important for students too, because telescope time really gets expensive, and if you can't do cutting edge science because it takes so much money, you have to do the follow up work. Then that's what amateurs are doing today, is follow up work for these discovery missions, right? So, But students don't get into astrophysics and astronomy to do follow up work. I don't think that drives everything.
No. And they certainly don't just to reanalyze the same data set 20 times over by 20 different teams,
right, I
think, which is what it would be like if there's just one telescope with hardly any data.
That's right. Yeah, so I do look forward to more space telescopes, more you know, if we colonize the moon, we definitely should be getting involved in astronomy there too, mm-hmm. You know, I don't think that we'll ever get to the point where we stop looking and searching, but the money problem is definitely there. Let's see. I asked while we were on the topic of life in the universe, how many of members of our chat group thought, you know, predicted that we'd find life, and I think that it's definitely in the majority. Most people believe that, if it happened here, it's had to have happened someplace else. You know, I think that if I was a betting man, that's what I would bet on too. But keeping an open mind is very, very important. I think that one of the great takeaways of this particular talk is, you know, the privilege that we've had tonight to talk to a scientist and to understand, to get into some of the inner workings of a scientist's thought process and mind. And so that's a real gift. So thank you. That's wonderful.
Yeah, no, it's my pleasure. Yeah, I totally understand why it's natural to take an example and assume it must be common. But I guess the problem is there's a selection bias, and that's where things get really tricky, because we wouldn't be here had there not been a success. So just saying there was a success here, therefore there must be lots, begets that. It kind of negates the fact that our existence is predicated upon that happening. So it's really difficult to use that happening as a data point to make inferences, which is kind of tacitly what you're doing when you say it's here, therefore it must be elsewhere. So that this is why it just requires a bit of careful thought with approaching it.
Sure. Well, that's great. So what's on your plate now? What's in the next 5 years for you?
5 years? What's the next 5 days? Is a pretty is a low player. No.
Do you think that far ahead?
I tend not to be honest with you. I always have projects kicking around that I'm excited about that have maybe time scales of sort of a year. But yeah, I like to remain flexible and nimble and see opportunities come up and be able to quickly jump on them. I don't like to commit myself to a 5-year project because then a really exciting opportunity might come along and you can't jump on it because you're too weighed down by something else that, you know, I don't like letting projects down. If I commit to something, I want to see it through. So yeah, we have a few things in the works. I'll tell you one paper I'm looking forward to talking about soon is just asking the question, why do we live around a yellow star and not a red star?
Right.
That's something I've been thinking about a lot recently. And that's again, getting down to this sort of one data point type issue that I'm so fascinated about, but there are so many red dwarfs. They make up 3/4 of all stars in the universe. They seem to have more Earth-sized planets in the habitable zone around them than sun-like stars do, from what we can tell. And yet more, they live for far longer than the sun. So by all accounts, we should really, it's kind of weird that we live around a yellow star.
Right.
So I've sort of been studying this quite hard recently, and I'll be excited to maybe share some results about that once my papers come through peer review.
Oh, very good. Very good. And when can we expect to maybe see your next papers? Do you know? Do you know when they will?
Well, you know what? I had one out today. So you can check out. If you've got an archive today, you'll see. We just discovered a planet that was announced today.
That's a good thank you. Congratulations.
Before I let you go, let's talk about that just a little bit. And then we'll.
Sure. I'll give you the very quick synopsis. It was a TESS. It was really the signal was found by TESS, but it was just a planetary candidate. We were able to confirm it by actually noticing that archival radial velocity data had already been taken for this star in the past. And so we found that, we looked at it, and it has exactly the same period as the real signal that TESS observed. And so that allowed us to confirm and actually even measure its mass and radius quite precisely. Mm. What's kind of neat about it is it's pretty bright. It's 8.7 magnitude. So it's quite accessible. It's a southern target. It's like -40 deck, I think. But it's the planet is a Neptune size. It's about a third of Mercury's orbit around the sun. And the sun is an absolute doppelganger. The star is an absolute doppelganger of the sun. It really is like sun 2.0. And so it kind of raises interesting questions. How did this Neptune 2.0 around a sun 2.0 end up in a radically different orbit to where Neptune truly, what went wrong in that system? Because presumably it started in the same initial conditions. And so this has been like really fascinating to me, to like try and figure out what the hell happened in this system. So yeah, that paper's out tonight or last night, and it's still in the archive, I think, and you can go check it out.
I'll do that.
Right. So would people go to the Cool Worlds section of Columbia, or where would they find out more about what's going on, David?
Well, I tweeted that. So if you follow me on Twitter, if you have Twitter, you can catch that. I'm on David_Kipping, and I give a long thread explaining why this planet is so interesting. So check that out. And I will make a video about it probably next week. And this was actually discovered by an undergraduate, and the undergraduate who discovered it will certainly feature.
Right. And that's the Cool Worlds YouTube channel, correct?
Yeah.
Awesome.
Correct.
Okay. That's great. Jerry, do you have any other things you wanted to comment on before we wrap up?
No, I just want to thank David again. I really appreciate spending some time listening to you talk about the science and being able to ask you questions that interested me in particular. You know, I'm not sure how much the audience got out of it, but I really enjoyed talking to you about it, you know, so...
I think it was very interesting. I think it was very interesting, and it was It's a great honor to have you on, and I think we all learned something. So, thank you.
My pleasure. Thank you for having me on.
All right.
Thanks for everyone for tuning in.
Yeah, and thanks for the audience too. Great audience. We're getting the Cameron Gillis. Thank you, David. Terry and Scott, very interesting and enjoyable discussion. Much appreciated. Aaron Thompson, extremely interesting. People were, they loved it. So thank you very much. That's great. All right. So before I go, I will say we do a global star party, as you know, normally every Tuesday night, but this time it's going to be on Thursday night, February 4th. It will be co-hosted by the editors of Astronomy Magazine, and we have Dr. David Levy, who will be on there, and also Dr. Alan Stern will be on, and our focus is that it's the 115th anniversary of Clyde Tombaugh, who discovered Pluto after a long search for a planet X. And we're really happy to have those people on. It'll be a lot of fun. The Astronomical League will also be joining us for that one, as they normally do. And we hope that you join us. It'll be at 7 p.m. Central on February 4th on Clyde Tombaugh's birthday. So thanks very much, everyone, and keep looking up.
The Southern Cross Astronomical Society of Miami, Florida is proud to present the 2021 Winter Star Party Virtual Edition, February 8th through the 11th. Because of COVID, we will not be able to get together in person this year, but we won't let that stop us from getting together online with old friends and make some new ones. There will be all new presentations about double stars, astroarchaeology, Mars exploration, and more. Enjoy classic videos from past winter star parties by Tippi Dioria, Dr. Mike Reynolds, John Dobson, and more. There will also be door prizes, but you have to register online by January 30th. To register, please visit www.scas.org. Go to the Winter Star Party tab. Select 2021 Virtual Winter Star Party from the drop-down menu. Go to the bottom of the page. Enter your name and email address and press register. And best of all, it's free. Then join us February 8th through the 11th from 7 to 11 p.m. Eastern Standard Time on www.explorescientific.com/winterstarparty. Mark your calendar. See you there.